One of the greatest mysteries of the universe, for which we know painfully little about, is the question of dark matter. To be fair, it's the proposition in one form of ghostly matter that does not interact with normal matter, that can pass seamlessly through walls, existing almost entirely apart from the normal universe, at least the one that we see. It may be the normal universe, and there's reason to think that we're the anomaly. More on that in a bit. But the concept of dark matter is more than just that. The ghostly non-interactive part is just one aspect, but indeed may not exist. But if it doesn't, it puts equally weird options on the table, forms of matter that we've never seen and may not be able to detect, leading to effectively the same situation. Matter of a form that we do not understand that sits far outside of our day-to-day reality. But here's the strange thing. Dark matter, in whatever form you choose to view it, must exist. The story of why scientists think it exists and why they find it necessary and compelling starts with its discovery. And it's a very complicated story that starts far earlier than is generally known. It first makes an appearance in 1884 with Lord Kelvin. He looked at stellar velocities and the potential number of stars in the sun's neighborhood. His numbers, being so early, were incorrect. But in short, he essentially wondered what would happen if there were a very large number of stars in the interstellar medium around the sun that we simply can't see. This was built upon by Henri Poincaré, using the French term for obscure matter, but incorrectly concluded that dark matter must be less abundant than normal matter, but in his context, it just means matter we cannot see. That could have been a huge population of unlit asteroids for that matter. The idea came up again with Jacobus Kapteyn in 1922, and yet again in 1930 with Knut Lundmark, who correctly, we now know, realized that there must be much, much more mass in the universe than we can see. Jan Oort, of Oort Cloud fame, found the same thing just 2 years later, though again his work was ultimately shown to be an error. Regardless, it was already being set up that we see effects in the universe that are not consistent with its observed matter. Fritz Zwicky in 1933 did another study involving the Coma Cluster and also saw evidence of unseen mass, and actually coined the term dark matter in German. He realized that there had to be much, much more mass in the Coma Cluster, some 400 times than what we were seeing. His numbers also turned out wrong. It's less than that, but the point is, there is a clear discrepancy forming up. Further work involving the Andromeda galaxy's rotation and the rotation of another galaxy showed similar results. Something was definitely not quite right, but with so many wrong numbers, the idea did not yet have much traction. Cue in someone who is alive and well, and before he entered the SETI game, he was doing astrophysical research. It was Seth Shostak. Links to my interviews with Seth on Event Horizon in the description below. He's a radio astronomer, and in the 1960s he showed that the rotations of half a dozen galaxies were too fast in their outer regions. Without dark matter, these galaxies should not be holding together, and their stars should be flinging out, but they weren't. At the same time, Vera Rubin, Kent Ford, and Ken Freeman were doing similar work looking at galaxy rotation, this time in spectroscopy, and yet again, discrepancies were showing up. The results were confirmed, and in 1980, the results were published, showing that most galaxies have to contain at least 6 times more matter than they appear to, otherwise they'd be flying apart. But it wasn't just stars. There was other work going on at the time in radio astronomy that showed something else weird. The work was actually done at the 21 centimeter line in the radio spectrum. This is around 1420 megahertz, the hydrogen line, made so famous by SETI, and indeed the enigmatic WOW signal. But this finding shows why SETI astronomers look at that frequency. So atomic hydrogen emits radio at that frequency. It shifts around slightly if the hydrogen is moving, but it's centered there. And since we know that, so would aliens. So if aliens are doing radio astronomy studying the hydrogen clouds of the universe, they naturally are in a position to pick up a hello signal as opposed to some other random frequency, where no one knows where to look when you're transmitting. So the story of dark matter starts with a discrepancy in the rotation of galaxies. But there's more evidence to it than that. You also see an effect in clusters of galaxies. This is interesting because it's possible to measure the mass of a galaxy cluster in more than one way, scattering radial velocities, X-ray emission, and gravitational lensing. And of the three, they will give you an answer independent of the others. Again, the discrepancy appears and shows that dark matter must outweigh visible matter by at least 5 times. Another indicator is the cosmic microwave background radiation, where there are 2 fingerprints seen. One corresponds to normal matter, the other corresponds to dark matter. So far, most of this, one way or another, is based on gravity, the only interaction dark matter apparently has. But as many have pointed out, maybe dark matter doesn't exist, and our understanding of gravity at great distances is incorrect. After all, we still have no idea what gravity actually is. Cue in the bullet cluster. This cluster formed in the collision of 2 galaxy clusters. The weird thing about this grouping is that its seeming center of mass is way outside of where it should be. Dark matter explains this. But it is a stumbling block for any modified gravity theories because they generally do not explain the observations of this cluster. And in general, modified theories have not fared well under experimentation. But scientists are actively looking into it. But there's way more. Type 1a supernovae serve as a standard candle in astronomy and allow you to measure very long intergalactic distances. That in turn also allows you to measure how fast the universe was expanding in the past. This very clearly shows that the expansion of the universe is speeding up, and whatever energy is driving that is the basis for dark energy. But again, there is a discrepancy with dark energy. You end up with a leftover that behaves like matter, but you can't see it, thus dark matter. But perhaps the best piece of evidence for one idea about dark matter is the existence of a known particle that can be called dark matter. This is the reason that the idea of an unknown, massive, non-interactive particle is so well liked in science, because we already know of such a particle. It's the neutrino. The neutrino also interacts with other matter weakly, gravitationally and through the weak force, both of which are weak. Before the neutrino was confirmed a decade after it was hypothesized to exist, it quite literally was what we would today call dark matter. Now we detect and study them routinely, and it turns out that there were several types of neutrinos. Trouble is they don't account for dark matter, but nothing says there can't be other particles that weakly interact like the neutrinos. Get enough of those particles and you have dark matter. So it really isn't a far stretch. The neutrino quite literally does the same thing dark matter does. They not only are ghostly particles that pass through walls, they can actually pass through the Earth without a single interaction and emerge from the other side and go on their way. And they aren't even hypothesized anymore. They are detected and proven to be there. As to what kind of particle is responsible for dark matter, it remains unknown, and there are no shortage of candidates. It could be anything from a new type of particle to an entire dark matter world made up of dark atoms that do not interact with us in many ways, but does with itself. But there may be a way to unravel this mystery independent of astronomy, the particle accelerator. There is still plenty of room for normal matter to account for dark matter, however. You just need some kind of matter that's not easily seen, such as tiny primordial black holes. But if dark matter is indeed a particle, then there are hypothesized ways to detect it in high-energy particle accelerators. So far, there is nothing to report on this front, but there are planned future experiments to try. So there are multiple indicators that lead scientists to conclude that dark matter is the best option to fit what we see. Multiple ways to test it, but also ways to dissent. And the idea of a modified theory of gravity remains in the sights of groups of scientists. But these days, dark matter faces less challenges than it once did. It was once a subject of much skepticism in science. But it simply fits best with what scientists observe. What we do know, however, is that we don't know what it is, and we don't have a good theory of gravity anyway, other than general relativity. And often in science, things end up far more complicated than they originally seemed when you start figuring things out, opening up the way for dark matter to be more complicated than just a single type of particle. There could be many, or it could organize itself into atoms and reveal an entirely new aspect to the universe, existing almost entirely apart from what we see. What is clear, however, is that any new information we glean deepens the mystery, and makes it not only the most abundant form of matter in the universe, whatever it is, but potentially the most interesting. And it pays to remember, since our form of matter doesn't interact with dark matter either, then to anything that may be there, we and everything we see is in fact dark matter. We are dark matter from a different perspective. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently addressing a huge question. The connection between dark matter and dark energy, which is not understood at the moment, and if I had to guess, a source of a whole lot of new mysteries in astronomy and physics, I'd say that one's a good bet. Really spooky, this topic, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.